In wandering through the vast, dark forest about them, the Pygmies long ago learned to collect honey stored up by wild bees, to collect it for food and for an article of barter. Here they have discovered a bee tree. A giant liana, or vine, forms a natural ladder for those who climb the tree. Meanwhile, their comrades on the ground make a basket to store the honey. The framework is of interlaced vines, inside which leaves will be placed. The tree climbers use a smudge to drive away the bees, while their comrades finish their most practical receptacle for the sweet honeycomb. Although many pygmies lose their lives in such dangerous climbing, it still is a popular pursuit, for honey is a delicacy to add to their food supply, and beeswax is valuable as an article of trade. A little snack now, even before allowing their tribesmen in the village to join them. The leader doles out the delicious morsels to his helpers. The inner bark of the malumba tree is used to fill the pygmies' clothing wants, which, as we have seen, are simple. After the tree is felled, the bark is peeled off whole, and preparations are made to separate the worthless outer bark from the inner. This is done simply by stripping it back, leaving the inner bark in one piece. This is folded back upon itself and pounded with a piece of solid ivory scored at the bottom. The pounding thins out the tough, crisscross fibers and is repeated until the cloth acquires the desired texture. This operation completed, the bark cloth is hung up in the sun. The warmth aids in expelling moisture left in after pounding is finished and also toughens the fibers. Thus, the inner bark becomes a fairly soft, durable cloth provided by nature. Now for material to dye the cloth. These pygmies are using a piece of kula wood, which has a rich, warm, brown tone. They rub it upon the surface of a stone, applying water from time to time. When enough dye has been secured, it is rubbed well into the bark cloth until an even color is obtained. From this bark cloth, the pygmies make their clothing, and they sometimes use it for trade. With cloth, beeswax, and other articles of barter on hand, it is decided to go on a trading expedition. The Sultani now leads his men to one of the hiding places of their most valued possessions, elephant tusks. Eager for a safe journey to the trading post, he warns of threatening clouds, the approach of the rainy season. All speed must be employed. The tusks represent many elephant hunts. Although the pygmies are little more than 4 feet tall, they are exceptionally strong and are skilled hunters of the vicious African elephants. They often move their villages in order to stay close to their huge quarry. Elephant meat is another of their foods, and neighboring tribes provide a ready market for ivory. Now the tusks are all accounted for, 3 dozen of them, hundreds of pounds of ivory, which eventually will find its way to many parts of the world. The Sultani urges his men back to the village with the tusks. Final preparations must be made quickly for transporting the articles of barter through the dense forest to the most easily available trading village. It is an occasion of real excitement for the entire village. Women and children welcome the party. Each member now goes quickly to his hut to assemble and pack other articles which are to be used for trading. Since the trip is vitally important, the Sultani asks the tribe's witch doctor to pray to Mungu, the great god of this hunting people of the forest, for safe passage for the party. At the little shrine of Mungu, the witch doctor makes careful preparations for his prayer. Leaf trays are arranged inside. On these, offerings will be placed when the trading party has returned. And now, leafy paths for the feet of Mungu. A path of leaves all about the shrine, so Mungu will not fail to find it. And leafy paths to and from the shrine to guide Mungu's coming in and going out. And now all is ready for the witch doctor's prayer. Hold back the wicked rain, O Mungu. Grant us safe passage on our journey. In the village, all is in readiness. Packages are being tied. This cloth, neatly folded, may be traded for a bunch of bananas, which do not grow wild, and for which, therefore, the pygmies must barter. The witch doctor reports. Having completed his priestly task, he is not above shouldering a tusk and doing his share of work. Now the party can depart on their long journey, secure in the belief that they will obtain good bargains in trading and that they will return safely. Word has reached the chief of a nearby tribe that the party of Pygmies is approaching, and he has all his articles of trade neatly arranged. Here we can see how small the Pygmies are by comparing them with these Congo natives of normal size. Greetings are exchanged between the Sultani of the Pygmies and the native chief. Handshaking is a common practice among these African tribes. Trading day is an occasion of importance, and the barter begins only after each group is seated. The Pygmy Sultani first shows the wares he has brought. We have seen the preparation of bark cloth by the Pygmies. These pieces have had designs added to them. We have seen them making bows, of which they now offer their surplus. One of their members has caught a toothsome anteater, which he now exhibits with some difficulty. Village children run in to watch as the other chief shows his wares. His tribe cultivates plantains. Here are dried plantains for grinding into flour. His tribe has cultivated bananas also. And here are manioc roots, which are a common food in this region. His craftsmen have made iron-pointed spears and knives of iron refined by the natives themselves, and slender, keen blades to be bound to sticks and used as axes. Now the two chiefs bargain. The Pygmy Sultani offers a prime tusk of ivory. What will the chief give him? Well, perhaps two iron-headed spears, valuable in elephant hunting. If this is not enough, then two axe blades also. The Pygmies need such tools. Still not enough. Well, perhaps a large keen knife in a leather case with a handy shoulder strap. This clinches the trade. Finally, loaded down with bunches of bananas, dried plantain, tools of iron, and packages of precious salt, the Pygmy trading party arrive back at their village. The products of trade will be distributed to all. Everyone is pleased with the outcome of the venture. The witch doctor is sent at once back to the shrine of Mungu to offer thanks. Thanks for a safe journey and for good bargains. Going immediately to the little shrine of Mungu, great god of the forest, he offers dried plantains, one of the most delicious pygmy foods. Salt, most precious of all goods to the little forest people, also is offered on a Mgongo leaf. The witch doctor's faith in Mungu is clearly evident. So likewise is his delight that Mungu has protected the party on its journey and has brought it safely back. Eagerly, the witch doctor offers thanks to Mungu, god of the shy little brown-skinned people, the nomadic hunters of this tropical forest.